Hey, what's going on YouTube? This is CJ. It's time to give you guys another quick update on the 9-gallon Peninsula Nano Reef Tank, also known as my office tank. Now, this thing's been running for roughly 8 months at this point. You know, time has really flown by on this little system. And to be honest, I've really enjoyed every month of it. It's really maturing. It's looking really good. And I'm even better. You know, I get to sit back and enjoy this 8 hours a day while I'm at the plantation. So with that being said, you know, when it comes to maintenance, keeping the glass clean has really been a challenge here lately. You know, I've switched back and forth between mag floats and the nano flipper. Neither one, it does better than just the old fashioned, you know, scraper getting in there and scraping the coralline, hard algae, or anything else that builds up on the glass. So, you know, I've been trying to be more consistent with my water changes, at least getting 5 to 10 gallons changed a month, which on this tank is a lot, but we're going to talk about why I'm doing that. You know, by all accounts, these nano tanks can be as easy or as difficult as you want them to be. You know, depending on what you want to keep, if it's just going to be a whole bunch of, you know, mushrooms and zinnia and Kenya tree and soft corals, then honestly, you can pretty much fill it up and kind of set it and forget it. But if you want to dibble and dabble in a few other types of corals, like I've been doing in this system, whether it be euphilias, you know, trumpet corals, you know, monies, easy to keep SPS, basically anything that builds in hard skeleton is going to consume a lot more alkalinity, calcium, magnesium, and everything else that we care about when it comes to keeping stable in any reef aquarium, you know, whether it's a nano or a huge tank. It's just the problem is in a nano system, things happen to change rather quickly because you don't have much water and you don't have much leeway when it comes to fluctuation. Now, with that being said, these hard corals are still not my biggest adversary. It's going to be this purple stuff, you know, this good old coralline algae that everyone loves in the reef tank, at least when you first start the hobby, right? I was the same, and honestly, I still enjoy it. It looks really good, and it helps add a sense of maturity to this little nano tank that I really, at this point, don't even have in my 120-gallon. That's the good news. The bad news is in a small system like this, the more this stuff grows, the more it is consuming all of that alkalinity and calcium and driving those numbers down to zero faster than almost any other coral that I've put in this tank up to this point. So, you know, it's kind of a give and a take. I like the good paint job on the rock work, but I don't like the consequences of dealing with this coralline algae. But I think it's all good. You know, between the corals, the coralline, it all boils down to one thing. How am I going to maintain my parameters? You know, there's a bunch of different methods of doing this, whether it's two-part or calc or calcium reactors or whatever method you choose. So I'm going to try a few different ones on this nano and see which one works better for me long term. Now, before we get into my master plan, I want to share my master fail with my livestock in this nano tank. You know, when it comes to everything that was already there, they're fine. You know, the pistol shrimp, goby pear is fine. The fire shrimp, the cleaner shrimp, they're all doing fantastic. Even the maroon gold striped clownfish is doing great. That's not the issue. The issue is trying to find this third, you know, free swimming, you know, entertaining fish to have in my reef tank. Now, I failed miserably with a Macosta wrasse, a furry wrasse at first. Learned my lesson. So I decided to try a more aggressive wrasse. You know, usually six-line wrasses can stand up to anyone that bothers them and usually can hold their own. Unfortunately, in this nano, that was not the case. So this six-line was rather big, you know, almost the same size as the clownfish. But after a week in the tank, he ended up dying. And a day later, this is all that was left of that guy. You know, the good news is I've confirmed twice that the cleanup crew on my tank is very efficient, scary efficient at dismantling fish and just completely, you know, taking them all the way down to the bone to where there's nothing left. The bad news is I still don't know what that third fish can be. And I'm almost coming to the point to where I'm thinking I may have to remove that clownfish to add any other fish to the system. So you guys let me know your thoughts on what that mysterious third fish could be in this nano tank. Now, for those who are new to my channel or if you're curious at, you know, how this nano tank is set up, 8 months ago, started with live rock, live sand, a bag of seeded pond matrix from an existing tank, lights and flow, and that's it. That's how it's been running for the last 8 months, and this is how it looks. It's pretty amazing how simple a nano can be and still look good. You know, with all those things being said, the parameters are not absolutely perfect, but we're going to take a look at them anyways. Now, according to my Hannah and Salaford test kits, the alkalinity in this tank was reading 7.04, calcium was 550, a little high, magnesium 1370, and my phosphates 0.24, which is also a little higher than I would usually want in the system. But like I said, considering I don't run any media, no skimmer, nothing on this tank besides water changes for the last 8 months, I'm pretty happy with the result. Also keep in mind, there's not much algae at all, if any, in this system. Tons of coralline, corals look happy, so this is one of those situations where if the numbers are not perfect, it's okay. But the question is, how am I going to maintain those numbers? Because this tank is really sucking alkalinity every day. By my estimate, according to my test, anywhere between 0.3 to 0.5 DKH per day. So that's where we come in with dosing. You know, I've never been a fan of dosing. I've never really wanted to do it. But on this tank, it's going to be necessary and mandatory unless I want to do water changes, you know, every day. So my two options are going to be BRS two-part and calc. I'm going to use a combination of both on this system, at least for the time being. I'm going to keep two-part on hand to help, you know, keep the alkalinity where I want it. And then I'm also going to use the calc in small doses in my auto top-off until I get, you know, the right concentration to where my alkalinity and none of my numbers move. So that way this tank is a little more stable and I don't have to really make any other major changes to it. And I can just start adding corals and enjoying this thing the way I really want to. So that's pretty much the plan. You know, I'm not a expert, you know, chemist in the hobby or anything like that, but I do have a pretty good understanding that, you know, once you get your numbers where you want them with two part, you can help maintain them using calc with the supplementing alkalinity and calcium together and my auto top off and just rolling with it. So, you know, what's my future plans as far as this tank? With the way it's looking so far, I think I'm going to add a mixed reef, to be honest. I was thinking at first I was going to do a whole bunch of Xenia and GSP and easy corals, but I definitely think this tank has potential to grow, you know, monies, to grow bird's nests, to grow any other easy to keep SPS. So we're going to try them out and I'm going to keep you guys posted. So at this point, I've been blabbing long enough. Hopefully you guys enjoy this quick update on the Office Nano tank. And as always, hey, you guys can like, comment, subscribe. You guys keep doing what y'all do. Y'all be easy. Happy reefing.